Hello everyone, I am the Matted Kirby, and welcome to my channel, The Commander Tavern. The Commander Tavern is a channel dedicated to my favorite Magic Gathering format. The Brewery is a series on this channel showcasing my spicy brews under the deck text. On this episode of The Brewery, I'll be discussing my take on Thantis the Warweaver. If you like this deck or any of the cards I'll be mentioning throughout the video, please consider using my TCG Player affiliate link when purchasing those cards. You can find that link down in the description. It'll really help out the channel. The best way you can help support the channel is with my Patreon. For just $1, patrons get early access to scheduled videos on YouTube. You can find all the links down in the description. In fact, patrons got a chance to see this video earlier. Also, this episode was inspired by an idea I was mulling around with one of my patrons, Bad Hipster. So, this one's for you. Alright, let's get back to the episode. Thantis is a 5/5 spider with vigilance and reach for 3 generic, 1 black, 1 red, and 1 green. If that weren't enough to pass the vanilla test, Thantis has a static ability that forces all creatures to attack each combat if they're able to. So it's designed to make games short and hostile because there's nothing sweet about this spider. On top of that, Thantis gets bigger the more creatures attack us or a planeswalker we control. This might not seem like a huge deterrent at first, especially against horde decks, but we have ways around that. Essentially, this deck not only wants to take advantage of all the carnage on the battlefield, but it also wants to punish anyone foolhardy enough to send the aggro our way. First, let's see how we're going to survive our own machinations before we see how we're going to continue pulling the strings with forced combat. In case opponents realize that the best way to deal with our manipulation is via the tried and true method of player elimination. So we should prepare our defensive position before casting Thantis. Kazul Tyrant of the Cliffs taxes opponents' attackers. If they don't pay, then we get blockers. Granted, they can just attack with creatures that have evasion like Menace, Flying, Horsemanship, Shadow, etc. Or potentially a huge beater with Trample. But for those horde decks that I mentioned earlier, they might lose their weenie army to our Orgrimmar unless they sink a ton of mana into their Alpha Strike. Same goes for Koskan Falls. If you've been watching my channel enough, you know that I'm a sucker for homelands, and anytime I can include a card from that set anywhere, I do. There aren't many Pillowfort effects outside of white and blue, but this one performs just as well. You do have to tap down an untapped creature you control during your upkeep, but this is actually a good thing. Since we are also forced to attack, just tap down a utility creature you don't want to risk dying in combat. So this enchantment actually performs double duty. And who says that homelands is the worst expansion ever? Crawl Space also helps protect us from attacks regardless of mana. Although this prevents Alpha Strikes against us, it doesn't really help against Voltron decks, but one step at a time. At least this prevents us from getting overwhelmed from the entire table sending their armies towards us out of spite. Maze of Ith, Mystifying Maze, and Lambeth of Scarfalls are the deck's pieces against Voltron threats. As long as it doesn't have Hexproof, we can just remove the creature from combat altogether. However, Maze of Ith and Lambeth of Scarfalls can also be used defensively. If we don't want to lose one of our creatures that we're forced to attack, we can remove them from combat. As a bonus, the Labyrinth can also remove blockers from combat to make sure a specific attacker goes through and smacks the opponent. Kirkkeep and Westvale Abbey are some more utility lands that can help against any attackers that slip through by creating a chump blocker. A lot of times opponents don't pay attention to lands, so these can be quite surprising if they've been on board for a while. The Abbey also doubles as quite the beater if you manage to transform it into Ormendal Profane Prince. Ormendal is a 9/7 with Flying, Lifelink, Indestructible, and Haste, so he's no joke. Believe it or not, Lifelink is the most important part of this keyword soup, since damage does go around in this deck, so it's always great to have ways to gain it back while also dealing a lot of damage to an opponent. Brash Taunter and Stuffy Doll are some more blockers in case any creatures go through. These blockers are amazing because not only are they indestructible, but they also dish out that same damage to opponents. With the Taunter, you can choose the opponent with each trigger, but the Doll requires the opponent to be chosen when it enters the battlefield. But that's not really an issue, as we'll see much later in the video. Hornet Nest and Ancient Stone Doll are two other amazing blockers in the deck. Not only does Hornet Nest have Defender, making it unable to attack with Thantis on the battlefield, but when it does block, you create that many 1/1 flyers with Death Touch that are even better attack deterrents. Ancient Stone Idol can be flashed in response to an attack with the potential of costing 0 mana to get a 12/12 onto the battlefield. It's safe to say that this will more than likely kill whatever it blocks. Then it becomes a 12/12 Trampler afterwards. And when it dies, it replaces itself with a 6/12, giving you yet another blocker and or beater. Speaking of flashing in responses, Beast Within, Chaos Warp, and Assassin's Trophy are instant speed responses against attackers that need to die at once. These cheap to cast spells can also be used against any other permanent that requires removal, so they're just amazing catch-alls in the deck anyways. At least Slender Shaman breaking through lets us destroy an artifact or enchantment that player controls, so it's kind of a naturalize on a body. It does have to get through though, which shouldn't be a problem, if Thantis forced that player to attack with everything, leaving them open to attacks. As for more instant speed responses to attacks, Arachnogenesis, Sudden Spoiling, and Constant Mists are also amazing instants that can be used in response to too many creatures breaking through. The first two in particular are amazing combat tricks in potentially killing off all creatures we're able to block with ours. Sudden Spoiling is especially brutal since it'll also remove all abilities from an opponent's creatures, specifically Hexproof, Shroud, Protection, and Indestructible, meaning any of their major threats much easier to deal with. Arachnogenesis also gives us creatures afterwards that we can then overrun the board with. Constant Mists is the all-star here though since it's a recurrable fog effect. Granted, we have to sacrifice a land per turn, but the deck is running Crucible of Worlds, which can also allow us to play a land per turn. So long as we don't have to cast Constant Mists 3 times before our next turn, we should be fine. The Crucible isn't just for Constant Mists either, since it can also help us replay our fetch lands to never miss a land drop while also thinning the deck of lands. But we'll see the deck's lands at the end of the video. Dragonlair Spider helps us keep a steady stream of blockers. Every time an opponent casts a spell, we create a token. This is especially crucial when they're casting creatures. Granted, we have to attack with them if we had Thantis out, but they're still chump blockers when opponents are casting spells before the other players are attacking. So we can get blockers that way, as well as some weenies to help swing in with. Golgari Gemination and Open the Graves also help us maintain some form of stream of blockers. Every time a non-token creature we control would die, it replaces itself with either a Cyberlink token or a zombie token, or both if we have both enchantments out for double the blockers. Not only are these great at helping us replace any creature that dies in combat, but after a board wipe as well. If an opponent, or even us, had to wipe the board, chances are that we still have a bunch of creatures afterwards to keep smashing face with. But at the very least, we get some chump blockers in between turns before ours to stop some things from getting through. And if anything would manage to get through, Dread and No Mercy will have opponents think twice. Unless we were to die from their attack, any creature that dealt damage to us would die afterwards. Dread is also a great attacker since it's a 6-6 with fear, which is a kind of evasion. If that weren't enough, if it were to die, it gets shuffled back into the library instead. These cards have opponents not attack us out of the risk of losing their creatures unless they do the math necessary to one-shot us, but hopefully by then we have any responses to keep us alive. Either way, Platinum Angel and Platinum Empyrean pretty much prevent us from losing, albeit the Empyrean only does so from damage and life loss. These might seem overcosted, but in a deck with access to green, we can cast these without much effort. They're also decent beaters for the cost, with the Empyrean being an 8-8. Last but not least, we can prevent combat altogether by goading creatures with Bloodthirsty Blade, Geode Rager, and Cardur Doomscourge. The equipment can only prevent one attacker at a time, but at least it makes sure it doesn't come to us, especially if it's a commander and or some unblockable beater that can really deal us damage. The elemental is even more useful if we manage to get Crucible of Worlds. As I mentioned earlier, if we're recurring a fetch land with it each turn, that's 2 landfall triggers we get for Geode Rager, preventing at least 2 out of 3 opponents from hitting us next turn. Carter does something better by making all creatures all opponents control attack other players besides us. The only downside is that it only does so when it enters the battlefield. But these effects are still amazing because they're backup plans to Thantis as well. Now, as for Cardur, we can reset it with one of the defensive effects of the deck, which is Temur Sabertooth. This creature is crazy good in this deck. We can bounce back key creatures in response to a board wipe, but we can also bounce creatures we might want to recast, like Cardur in this case. If we're able to get this combo going, we won't ever be attacked unless it's just us against the lone survivor of the other opponents. The Sabertooth also helps us reset Stuffy Doll, if you remember from earlier. If the opponent chosen with it loses, we can just bounce it back and recast it again to choose a different opponent. Keep in mind that it can also be used for combat tricks such as bouncing any creature that had to attack but we didn't want to lose to combat. Same with blockers. It's definitely one of the best cards in the deck. As for those board wipes, it can help us with, Chandra's Ignition is one of those. If we target our biggest creature with it, it'll wipe the board of all other creatures while also burning opponents. Bonus points if cast with either Stuffy Doll and or Brash Taunter on the battlefield. More bonus points with Fiery Emancipation, Dictate of the Twin Gods, and or Fiendish Duo on the battlefield, so this card will do some serious damage. We could just use the Sabertooth to bounce anything we don't want dying, and doing so will also make itself indestructible to survive too. Heroic Intervention can also help with this regard as well. Although used defensively to protect our board from a board wipe or to protect our blockers from a buffed up army or other combat tricks, we can also cast this in response to Chandra's Ignition to protect our board. We can then swing in unopposed and pretty much seal the deal. Granted, it's mostly for defensive purposes, but can be used offensively as well. Rise of the Dread Marn is another response to a board wipe, but it's not as defensive as Heroic Intervention, since we'll probably still lose our creatures to the Wrath effect. But we do get a zombie token for each non-creature token that died from it, not just our creatures either. So if someone wipes the board and we have this, it'll definitely make them regret casting the Wrath, since now we have the only creatures left with which later Alpha Strike the rest of the table for the win. However, the best board wipes might be our own, thanks to Plague Wind and Ingoruk's Wake. Now, we don't really want the board to be wiped since we want all of our opponents to kill each other with their creatures. So we want to be as defensive as possible without actually wiping the board too often. But we do need some backup, especially when it's down to one-on-one. These might seem a bit overcosted in terms of board wipes, but as I mentioned earlier, we don't really struggle with mana acceleration. Plus, these are more for the late game, when our army of creatures is enough to take out any remaining opponents in a single attack phase, especially if we cast Rise of the Dead Marn afterwards. So make sure you foretell it when you can, because that way it only costs one black mana to cast from exile. Last but not least is Vandal Blast. Sure, it's used mostly to get rid of any pull-up forts in artifact form or any other annoying stack pieces, but it will also set opponents back who have a lot of mana rocks. But believe it or not, there's also plenty of artifact creatures in the format, so this also doubles at getting rid of a couple of creatures. So while it's a staple in many red decks, it can do more than its default purpose. One more way the deck can buffer table-wide aggression is with Exquisite Blood. If we do manage to have opponents hit each other instead of us, we're going to gain a ton of life for it. That way we have a healthy enough life total for when opponents band together or find ways to get rid of our defenses and come swinging into us. You can include Sanguine Bond if you want to have access to the insta-win combo, but since Sanguine Bond doesn't do anything on its own in the deck, it's not included. But you can definitely include it if you wanted to. Glacial Chasm is the final card I'm going to discuss before explaining how the deck aggros are against the table. Ironic, since it prevents us from aggroing out. It reduces all damage dealt to us to zero. Granted, this nombos with Dread and No Mercy and might make opponents attack us instead since we won't take damage. However, if we have our pull-up fort effects in play, they'll still have to pay any taxes. That and Thantis gets bigger the more we're attacked. The cumulative upkeep might seem steep, but Exquisite Blood gains us enough life to deal with it for a while. At least until the board is at a state where us entering their fray gives us the largest potential for winning the game. Either way, thanks to Crucible of Worlds, we can play both the land we sacrifice to it, as well as the Chasm itself, if the amount of age counters on it gets too high, and it's better to sacrifice it to its cumulative upkeep, and then play it again afterwards. As I mentioned earlier, the deck lacking white and blue for the pillow fort effects means that we had to rely on multiple forms of protecting ourselves from the table, turning their aggression against us. But now that we saw how to mitigate and convince opponents towards someone else, whether with fear-inducing manipulation or not, let's see how we can then magnify the damage they're going to be dealing to each other. That way they kill each other off, and we have to just worry about that one weakened opponent with few resources left at the very end. Sower of Discord has us choose two opponents when it enters the battlefield. It does its job of sowing discord exceedingly well. Most of the time, the opponents chosen tend to team up together to prevent hurting each other too badly. Since they can't go after us, they end up ganging up on the remaining player who isn't affected by the demon. However, when that player attacks either opponent, the other one loses that much life too. If we attack the affected opponents, they will fall rather quickly, and then it's just us and the remaining opponent. Don't forget that the demon is a 6-6 flyer for just 6 mana as well, so there's also that. Frontier Moralmonger also presses opponents for looking elsewhere when attacking. Since their creatures gain menace when attacking other opponents, their creatures will be harder to block, and thus they might send them towards opponents just to try and protect them from dying to combat damage. Also, it makes it easier for opponents to end up hitting each other since they have to attack. So their only available blockers are creatures with Defending or Summoning Sickness. Fire Emancipation, Dictate of the Twin Gods, and Fiendish Duel, which I mentioned earlier, also help accelerate our opponents dying off like flies. These effects help multiply the damage our opponents are going to be receiving as well as their permanents. Even though the first one is only from sources we control, it triples instead of doubles, so I ain't even mad. Also, remember Stuffy Doll and Brash Taunter? These synergize amazingly well with them. Let's say Brash Taunter were to take 5 damage, the Dictate makes it so it receives 10 damage instead. Since the Taunter receives 10 damage, it's going to deal that much to an opponent. However, again, thanks to the Dictate, that's 10 damage is actually 20 damage to the face, and that's just from taking 5 original damage. While these kinds of interactions make the cards really busted in the deck, the better part is that they're still amazing on their own, since the Dictate and Devil work even if opponents are hitting each other, which is great. Along that same vein is Wound Reflection. This is just brutal since it triggers at every end step, so opponents getting hit each turn from whatever effect will have that pain given to them at the end of each turn. This is especially painful with Sower of Discord on the battlefield, since it has another opponent lose life and when the other receives damage. As to making our own things even more dangerous, both Nylea, Oron Frostfang, and Archetype of Finality give all of our creatures Death Touch. Granted, if everyone's forced to attack, it's not very likely that many blockers will be available. That being said, these make sure our creatures kill whatever they hit, especially the Archetype since it takes Death Touch away from our opponent's creatures just in case. The Frostfang also doubles as a way to fill our hand with each creature that connects to an opponent, which is obviously a huge plus. The Bow is also a sort of Swiss Army knife since it does have a modular activated ability where all of its modes are relevant. Now, combine Death Touch creatures with Nylea, God of the Hunt, and you've really got something. Creatures with Trample and Death Touch mean that they only have to deal 1 point of damage to a blocker and then Since the blocker takes lethal damage, the rest of the damage goes to the opponent. Oh, and she's a 6-6 indestructible creature when devotion is met. If that weren't enough, Nylea is also an amazing mana sink to pump all of your creatures to make the most of your combat. Speaking of making the most of your combat by pumping your creatures, Vigor and Beastmaster Ascension do an excellent job of that. The enchantment can very easily get the counters needed to give your creatures +5/+5, which is no joke. Vigor's even more busted, and not just because it's a 6-6 trampler for 6 mana, but whenever a creature you control would receive damage, it gets that many +1/+1 counters instead. That's just insane for a deck like this one. Just imagine having Vigor on the battlefield before you cast Signs of Ignition. Crazy. Oh, and just like Dread, it shuffles itself back into your library when it hits the graveyard. Asceticism also provides some defensive boons to our creatures by giving them all hexproof. We can also regenerate a creature for just 2 mana. It's definitely helpful during combat as well as bypassing any wraths and spot removal without the can't be regenerated clause. Swarmyard does it for free, and since it's on a mana producing land that doesn't come into play tapped, it doesn't take up a slot in the deck. Granted, Swarmyard is more for protecting Thantis since it's a spider, but at least there's 3 more creatures in the deck it can target. Going back to keeping up the aggression, Morok, Fury of Akum gives you extra combat phases with its landfall ability. As seen in the beginning of the video, it is possible to trigger landfall each turn. However, Ashaya, Soul of the Wild is also in the deck to further cement that landfall synergy. With Ashaya on the battlefield, each non-token creature entering the battlefield under your control will also trigger Morog, which is insane. Morog not only gives you additional combat phases, but it untaps all of your creatures as well and pumps their power for each time they've attacked. This can make short work of your opponents if you manage to get a decent engine going. Ashaya making all of our non-token creatures into lands can also provide the secret tech of protecting your creatures from global effects that mention non-land permanents. So any Planar Cleansing being cast won't destroy our creatures, and any overloaded Cyclonic Rift won't hit our non-token creatures either. So remember that when these spells are cast when controlling Ashaya. Speaking of untapping our creatures, Seedwear Muse can make sure our creatures and other permanents are ready each turn. Attacking with all of our creatures each turn can be a bit dangerous if we don't have some sort of defensive cards on the battlefield anymore. At least the Muse can untap all of our creatures to block with them afterwards, but also untaps our lands and artifacts, giving us even more resources for paying any spells and abilities too. Besides Orin Frostfang to draw us cards off of creatures attacking, the deck has Tosky, Bearer of Secrets in it as well. Tonski might be a 1-1, but it's amazing since it can't be countered and, more importantly, is indestructible. It has to attack each turn anyway, so that's not an issue here. However, its triggered ability is amazing at keeping our hand full of cards, especially since Thantis makes it so opponents don't really have that many blockers available anyways. Return of the Wild Speaker, Rishkar's Expertise, and Soul's Majesty are included for more conventional card draw, especially since Thantis has a built-in potential of becoming much larger than its 5-5 base power and toughness. Return of the Wild Speaker also doubles as a global giant growth for your non-human creatures, which is a potential win con in this deck. And as always, bonus points for chaining Rishkar's Expertise into either Return of the Wild Speaker or Soul's Majesty. Reliquary Tower is included because there comes a point where this deck draws into a ton of cards and it doesn't really take up a slot in the deck. Besides, with all the way the deck generates mana, it doesn't color screw us either. Speaking of which, let's see how this deck accelerates our mana generation to help pay for some of these expensive spells. Cryptolith Rite is amazing in and of itself for this goal, but keep in mind that this turns all of our creatures into mana dorks that tap down for any color, meaning that when combat comes around, any creatures already tapped down won't be able to attack. So this enchantment performs double duty. It can be used to generate a ton of mana, but it can also be used to tap down any creatures we do not want to lose during combat, which is some amazing tech for a Thantis deck. Also of note is its interaction with Akum, Ashaya, and Temur Sabertooth. You can tap down creatures to generate enough mana to bounce a creature with a Sabertooth and then recast it to trigger Morog. This has the potential of giving us infinite combat phases. Dryad Arbor is the only pure mana dork in the deck, and that's because it's also a land. This can be fetched onto the battlefield for an instant speed blocker, since a lot of times opponents don't really pay attention to fetch lands, especially when it comes to using them to get a blocker. Farseek, Nature's Lore, Three Visits, Skyshot Claim, Ranger's Path, and Hunting Wilds are the more conventional ways to accelerate the deck, especially considering that so many commander players refuse to run mass land destruction spells and effects. Not only can these get us very far ahead, but they can also ramp us with dual type lands, which also help with mana fixing. They're also amazing at triggering landfall effects too in the late game, so they're useful in all points of a match. Soul Ring, Mana Crypt, and Arcane Signet are a bit weaker since they get destroyed to artifact hate, but their benefits outweigh the risks in a deck like this one. Granted, we don't need Thantis out as early as possible since we want to get our defenses up beforehand, but they do help in getting those defenses online faster. The rest of the deck is just the rest of the lands. The deck's running all 10 fetch lands, all 3 dual lands, all 3 shock lands, command tower, and Daragas's Caldera, as well as 3 of each snow-covered basic land in case anyone's running anything that benefits us for it. As always, the dual lands are not entirely necessary for the deck to run, and you can just as easily swap them out for budget alternatives and the deck will still run well enough. Specifically, you can swap them out for the 3 battle bond lands. Same goes for the more expensive fetch lands, but fortunately, they're going to supposedly be significantly reprinted in Modern Horizons 2, which isn't supposed to be a reprint set, but who cares, they're reprinting the fetch lands. This brews just an idea of how to build around Thantas the Warreaver. The deck is an aggressive and political deck, but it's not just smash face and be done with it. It seeks to take advantage of the chaos and force opponents to attack each other while you're either protecting yourself and attacking any defenseless opponents until it's just you versus a much weaker opponent with fewer creatures and resources. If you're interested in the decklist of this spicy brew of mine, you can find a link to it down in the description. I would like to thank all my patrons for supporting me, and a quick shout out to all my higher tier patrons, the Brewers, for their patronage, especially Bad Hipster, which inspired this video. I'd also like to thank anyone using my TGG Player affiliate link, that also helps out the channel. And to everyone, thanks for watching this episode of The Brewery on the Commander Tavern. I am Demented Kirby, and happy brewing!